heaven, there is freedom. In your presence, we are made whole. And all we want and all we need is coming in.
Every victory is found in Jesus Christ. I hope you live in that, knowing that in Christ you are a victor, you're an overcomer, you are triumphant in Him. And it's a wonderful thing to be in the presence of God today, to come into His house to worship and celebrate the awesomeness of our God. And I hope you know just how awesome, how great, how loving He is to you. He loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, that you, even a sinner, can know salvation and forgiveness and live in a relationship. Because of that, you come to worship and celebrate His goodness. If you have not already filled out your information card this morning, I ask that everybody do that, especially our guests that are with us this morning. We're glad you're here. We're going to have a great time celebrating the Lord this morning. We invite you to join in also. I want to lead us in a prayer this morning as we focus our hearts and our minds upon the Lord Jesus Christ. So join me as I pray. Father God, we come and we gather because we need You. We sense a need for You more than anything else, Father. We need You. We need to live in Your presence. We need to worship You. We need to gather to celebrate who You are and proclaim our dependence upon You. Father, even for things many times we're not oftentimes aware of, Father God, we need You. Even our breath, we need You. We give thanks to You today for being so good and for Your presence with us. I pray for some here today that are struggling with heavy things on their mind, on their heart, that's going on in their life, Father God. And I pray that as they're in Your presence today, and as they just open themselves to You, that You would move and work in their lives, resulting close to You, and they would know the comforting assurance of Your greatness and Your love. Thank You for what You'll do today, Father, as we give ourselves to You. In that wonderful name of Christ we pray.
My Savior be, and He's my Sovereign God. Would He be both that sacred head for sinners such as I? At the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Was it for Christ that I have done? He groaned upon the sea. Amazing pity, grace unknown, and love beyond degree. At the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
Continue to praise His holy name for His amazing grace, His wonderful love, and for His sacrifice at the cross this morning. In this
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose blood is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. He takes the whole earth with holy thunder, and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That You would take my place. That You would bear my cross. You lay down Your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that You've done for me. He brings the chaos back into order. He makes me orphan, a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King above all kings. He rules a nation with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that You would take my place, that You would bear my cross. You lay down Your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that You've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb. praise. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, that's been for all that you've done for me.
The kingdom of heaven is like a successful restaurateur who went out early one morning to high chef for the fabulous Boulevard breakfast.
He drank a double chef on the usual daily salary, and he busied himself in the kitchen preparing the cuisine du jour.
And about 9 a.m., the restaurateur noticed several people standing around on the sidewalk outside of Starbucks. He said, so they went to join the original chef.
Now, the restaurateur looked out again at noon and at 3 o'clock, and the same thing happened.
And the kitchen workforce continued to expand.
About noon, he took a spin at his BMW and noticed even more folks standing around at the beach doing
nothing.
Why are
you all sitting here idle all
day? He said. Nobody's hired us, they
replied. And so they did.
At closing time, in the wee hours of the morning, the restaurateur was serving his nice relief.
Bring in the bitter
and take it. If you want the bad, you can take it to the boat. When those hired off the beach at 5 to maintain, each of them received a full daily pay.
Seeing this, the ones hired first licked their chops, thinking they would get a great bonus. But each of them also received the basic daily wage.
And when they saw what had happened, they grumbled and complained about the restaurateur.
Who do you think you are? These last guys worked a few hours at best. And you made them equal to us, who spent the whole day and night slaving over your hot stove.
But the restaurant owner replied to his complaint.
Oh, it's free.
I hope you have been redeemed, born again, saved. You know that you're a child of God. There's nothing better to know that you're a child of God. Turn in your Bible to 1 Corinthians chapter 13, a familiar passage to many. We're talking on the subject this morning of how to grow in love, how to grow in love, how to show the love of God more and more in our lives. Take your outline, your sermon insert this morning. We have the review of what we talked about last Sunday on there, the outline and the scripture for the message this morning. But our focus is right here in this passage in 1 Corinthians 13, beginning in verse 1. This is a passage that many call the great love chapter, the great love passage of the Bible, and certainly has profound, great truths for us. 1 Corinthians 13, beginning in verse 1. If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I'm only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and surrender my body to the flames, but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It is not rude. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of the wrong. Love does not delight in the evil, but it rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always perseveres. Love never fails. The scripture says that love is so important. I can do a lot of things. I can have a lot of things. But if I have not the love of God, it means nothing. It's in vain. How do I grow more and more in this kind of love? I hope you were here last Sunday. I hope you were listening last Sunday. But if you weren't, you can go online and look at the part one where we talked about love. And we spent a lot of time talking about the difference between the world kind of love, what the world thinks love is, and what the Bible is talking about when it talks about God's love, agape love. It's the kind of love that our world needs so much. I put a definition of love, you know, on your outline. It's hard really to define love with just a simple definition, but I think it's important that we get a basic understanding of what something is, because it's such a difference and how the world thinks of love, and how the Bible describes love. And so I put this definition that biblical love, God's love, is about giving of oneself freely for the pure reason of helping others and connecting them with God without any selfish dreams or tasks or expecting something in return. It's giving of yourself for the purpose of helping meet needs, helping others, and connecting people with God, things we do or we're to do with a purpose, that it's to help people see God's love and connect them with God. But we are not expecting something in return. We're not doing it for selfish reasons to get something back. And we gave six kind of phrases that help us understand this love a little bit more. First of all, we said that love, true love, Bible love, is not just a feeling. Most of the time, the world thinks of love as a feeling. You know, I feel this fuzzy way about this person, or I like being around them. That's not what Bible love. It may include feelings, but it's not just a feeling. It's much more than that. And then secondly, we say that love is a matter of action. It's not just a feeling. It's not just something we talk about. It's an action. It's something we do. It's how we act. It's how we behave. Love is an action. Then third, we said it's not uncontrollable. Many times we think of love as being uncontrollable. Either that we have fallen in love or we've fallen out of love. If we're in or if we're out of it, we can't control it. Nothing we can do about it. And so that kind of justifies the way we act and the way we behave. But love is not uncontrollable. Because love, number four, is a decision. It is a decision that we make. It is a choice that we make. And that brings us to the fifth thing about love. It's not easy. It's hard. You know that. It's not hard to act in love when you don't feel like it, and then when you're trying to be loving to unlovable people, when you're trying to be loving to people that are not very lovable themselves. And then the sixth thing, very important, love does not accept, does not encourage, or promote sin. Any form, any fashion, any how, any why, any way, any time. Love does not promote sin. Our world is so confused about that. The world thinks by accepting sin, by encouraging sin, by applauding sin, that they're being loving, they're being accepting. But that's contrary to the teaching of the Bible, because sin is not good for people, it's harmful for people. Always is, always will be. Sin will be harmful for people. And so if I'm loving, I'm not encouraging something that is harmful for people. So we talked about the meaning of love, and it's so very important that we understand the difference between the world's love and Bible love, God's love, the love that our world needs so much. Then the second thing we said, that if I'm going to become more loving, that I must experience God's love. I must experience His love. I must experience the love of His salvation. It must flood my heart. And then if I'm a believer, I must be saturated in God's love so I can be more and more loving and give the love that our world needs. But third, what we want to spend a lot of time talking about this morning is that if I'm going to be more loving, I must think about what is best for others. I must think about what is best for others. Or another way to say that is I must have loving thoughts. I must have loving thoughts. I must think love if I'm going to act love. You see, so many times we want to act on the basis of our feelings. And so we feel a certain way, and so we do something in response to our feelings. If we're not feeling right, then we'll act wrong. Or we wait till our feelings are good in order to act good. But no, the Bible says you can't just click on a feeling. But what you can choose to do is to think right. You can choose to think loving. And as you think loving, and love is doing what is best for others, then it begins to affect your feelings. You don't wait for your feelings. You start doing what you can do about your thoughts, what you think about, and how you think what is best, what's right, or what others need. Many passages of Scripture talk about this, the importance of our thoughts. Philippians chapter 4, verse 8 says this, "Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things." So this is, you need to control your thinking. You need to attack how you live, but first of all, your thinking. And that phrase there, where he says, whatever is lovely, think on those things. And when I hear the word lovely, you know, I think of maybe a lovely flower, or a lovely sunset, or a cute, fuzzy puppy. You know, these things are lovely. We think, that's not what he's talking about. He's not talking about those warm, fuzzy things. He's talking about, think about things that are of love. And what is love? It is what is best for the other person. It's what the other person needs, or what is good for them, or what is right for them. So I am to think thoughts that are lovely, in that they are the thoughts of what this person needs, what is best and what is right for them. Look at Philippians 2, verse 3 and 5. It tells us that this is the way God thinks. And so if we're going to be like God, we need to think like God. Philippians 2, verse 3. "Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourself, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of the others. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus." And this is the way Jesus thinks. Jesus thinks about what people need, what is best for them. Those are in his thoughts. He doesn't necessarily say, oh, I got a feel that I want to do something good. He says, I have a thought about what people need. God is always thinking about us and what we need. best for us. He says, I don't wait for it. No, if Jesus had waited for the feeling to leave heaven, being waited on and attended to and worshipped by the angels, he would have never come to earth. But he said, I want to do what is best for the people, so I'm thinking about what people need. And so he left heaven, came to earth, to die on the cross. So I put this as a bullet point there on the bottom of the second page. Instead of thinking about a person's fault, think about their need. Instead of thinking about a person's fault, about their shortcomings, about their mistakes, you think about their need. Now, people have a long list, many times, of wrongs. And if you spend your time thinking about their wrongs, you won't be very loving toward them. But people who have the most faults need the greatest amount of love. The most obnoxious people, the most unloving people need the greatest amount of love poured upon them. You know what Jesus said? Jesus said it's not the well who need a doctor, it's who? The sick. The sick need to be outpoured the medicine. They need to be poured medicine upon. And the greatest medicine, the greatest healing that people need is the medicine of love. People sometimes want to ignore love. They want to ignore the receiving of love and giving desperately of the love that they need. But they need love. And everybody needs love. And if a person does not get love, many times they will act in a way to try to draw attention to them. And if they still don't get love, whether it's from the home or from a spouse or from their parents, whatever, if they don't receive love or the attention they think they want, many times they will try to get attention by destructive ways, by doing harmful things, because what they've been doing is not getting attention. They will act in ways that are destructive or harmful, or do bad things, but yet they're trying to get attention. They're trying to get love, because what everybody needs is love. And so the Bible says, instead of thinking about the person's fault, we think about what their needs are. People need love. So, don't wait for the feeling before you're loving. Start thinking loving thoughts. And the loving thoughts are, what do people need? What is best for the person? Not how they acting, but what do they need? That's loving thoughts. And then, number four, I must choose to act loving even if I don't feel loving. So we're talking about being more loving people. I need to act loving. I make the choice, because love is a decision, it's not just a feeling. I make the choice to act in a certain way, even if I don't feel like it. And we want the feeling. We want to feel loving. So we're attacking that from kind of two ways. We're attacking it with our thoughts. We're attacking it with how we're acting. And if you start thinking a certain way, it will begin to affect your feeling. And if you start acting in a certain way, it will affect our feelings. Now, we many times don't want to do that. We don't want to act until we feel in a certain way. But we must act even if the feeling is not there. See, this is so important in marriages. Because, you know, sometimes in marriages, you don't feel in love. Maybe a few years have gone by, some things and wrongs have happened in the marriage, and you don't feel in love. And when many times people don't feel in love, they say, well, you know, I've lost that love and feeling, so the marriage must go. Because they don't have the feeling. We act on the basis of feeling. But we don't live by feeling. We live by faith. We live by truth. And so we continue to choose to think loving thoughts, and we choose to act loving, even if we don't feel loving. It is love, as the Bible describes, that actually holds marriages together. You say, well, I want that loving feeling. Well, the loving feeling oftentimes doesn't stay there, sometimes it leaves. But if you think in love and you act in love, that feeling oftentimes comes later. So I'm to act in loving even when I don't feel it. And we do this in a lot of different areas of our lives, acting in a certain way, and then the feeling comes later. For example, let's say you've been given an assignment to do, and you're not very enthusiastic about it. You're not very excited about it at all, so you just, you know, grumble and you gripe and you complain about it. But then if you start thinking enthusiastic thoughts about it, and then start doing things that are in keeping with being enthusiastic about this, although you may not be all that excited about it, before long you start finding yourself kind of enthused about it. By the way, enthused in God, in God starts moving in the situation. You start thinking lightly and start acting lightly, and so you don't have the feeling, your feelings begin to be affected. And then about, how about, happy? So I don't feel very happy. And so because I don't feel happy, I'm not going to do happy. I'm not going to be happy. You know, well, you don't have to wait for the feeling. You can start thinking happy thoughts, and you can start acting happy. For example, you know, maybe say, put a smile on your face. Well, I don't feel like smiling. Well, who said you had that live by feeling? You can live by truth. You can do what's right. So you can put a smile on your face, and if you want to really top it off, just start laughing. Just start laughing. It is hard to laugh and keep laughing and not feel happy. Just try it sometimes. Don't do it in public. Somebody just says you're nuts. If you just start laughing around, or standing in the line, it's a while you're testing your patience, you know, so when you just start laughing, they may think, what's going on? But you try sometimes, you start acting happy, you start feeling happy. Or how about worship? Have you noticed? I can't find hardly any passages in the Bible that says, feel worship. But what does the Bible say? It says worship. Do worship. Think worship. Think about God. Focus on Him, and then worship Him. But have you ever noticed that sometimes you don't feel like worshiping? You may have woke up this morning and said, no, I don't feel like worshiping. What do you do when you don't feel like worshiping? You know what a lot of people do? They don't worship. They don't come to worship. And they live by feelings rather than the faith. Sometimes this may surprise you, but sometimes I don't feel like coming to worship. Can you imagine that speaking? Sometimes not feeling like worship. I may have had a bad day. Sometimes I may just feel blah. Maybe a lot of things going on, a lot of things, other things on my mind that allow me to control my thinking, and I just don't feel like worship. So what do you do? You better come to worship. And when you don't feel like it, you really need to come to worship. And then you come to worship, and you come in worship, and you sit down, and you sit here and say, well, I don't feel like doing that. I'm just going to sit. And then Brother Andrew says those dreaded words, everybody stand and sing heartily from your heart. Let a rip for Jesus. You know, yeah, I'm not singing. I don't feel like singing. I'm not going to sing. So you don't sing because you don't feel like singing. You don't feel like worshiping. You get up and you leave. You go out the door at the end of the service and you say, that was not a very good worship experience. I didn't like the song. Some of them didn't know. I didn't sing. I didn't want to sing. Preaching wasn't any good. God wasn't even there. Why not? Well, might have been you. May have been your thinking was wrong. May have been your action was wrong. What if, when you don't feel like worship, you say, well, I'm going to attack this from two different directions. I'm going to attack it with my thinking. I'm going to think upon the Lord. I'm going to decide. Before, you know, it's okay to force yourself to do something. Think about God instead of this problem. Instead of this blah or this, I'm going to think about God, and then I'm going to act worshiping, even if I don't feel like it. Brother Andrew says, everybody, stand to your feet and sing glory to God. And so you open your mouth, and you start singing. Start singing about God. We just sing about His amazing love. Sing about His love, and then you do something crazy, you put a smile on your face. You may not even feel like smiling. Sometimes I don't even feel like singing. You know, but start singing. And then let's say you get really crazy. You clap your hands. Or you may raise one if you're out there, you know, and let's say you raise both hands, you know, and you may not feel like, but you say, I'm just going to worship God. And what happens? Before you know it, you sense God's presence. You feel worship. And sometimes it doesn't happen immediately. Sometimes it happens in different levels and degrees. Well, see what we're talking about? We're talking about we want the feeling, but God doesn't say, okay, you feel this certain way, feel worship. We want the feeling, but you attack it where you're thinking, realize you think what is needful, what is right, and then you start acting, you start behaving in how you're to do and what you're to do. You act in worship, and then many times we want the feeling. happen. And you say, you know what? I felt God's presence. I felt God's moving. Why? Because we started asking, and what you were living by faith, not living by feeling. Now, in the passage that we read from 1 Corinthians 13, it tells us several ways that love acts. It says love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it does not keep a record of wrongs. It tells us all of these things about how we are to act, things that we're to do. But I want to give you another passage of Scripture that for Jesus said, this is what love does. This is how you love when it's hard, when it's not easy. This is how you love when you are at school and there's some people there that acting like jerks. Or in your workplace and you've got a bad ball. Or whatever. Look at this passage on your outline, Luke 6, verse 27. Luke 6, verse 27. It says, but to you who are listening, I say, you know, sometimes people were around Jesus and they weren't listening. They heard what he said, but they weren't really listening. But you got to be able to listen. You have to listen to your life expectations. This is hard. He says, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who mistreat you. If you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners love those who love them. But love your enemies. Do good to them and lend to them without expecting to give anything back. Remember we said that love in definition is not having strings attached, looking to get things back. He says, then your reward will be great, and you will be children of the Most High God, because he is kind to the ungrateful and to the wicked. He said, you want to look to the example, look to the example of Jesus Christ, because even to the ungrateful, even to the wicked, even to his enemies, he is kind. He says, why are we yet sinners? Christ died for us. So Jesus is talking about loving those who are not very lovable. How do you do that? How do you act? Well, three things, basically, he said. First of all, he said, do good. Do good. He said, do good to those who don't do good to you. He said, if you only do good to those who do good to you, you're acting just like the world. But if you do good even to those that do harm or do bad, then you're acting like God. Now, what kind of good things do you do? Well, the good is love, and so that is based upon what people need. Remember, we're not thinking about their faults, we're thinking about their needs. So what does this person need? Well, they need massive amounts of love. And so God will lead you to do good, to show love in specific ways if you pray and ask him. But that doesn't always mean that we put ourselves in danger or continued abuse by an individual who's not doing good. Sometimes we think, well, I got to be loving, I got to do good for them, I got to expose myself to their evilness in order to love them. But it's not always that way. You know, sometimes Jesus, it says he withdrew himself from certain people because they were intending harm. And it was not God's plan at that time for him to expose himself to them or even to be crucified at that time. So sometimes he withdrew himself. It was according to the Lord's leading. But do you know that God shows his love to different people in different ways? He doesn't kind of hesitate to say it this way, but God doesn't love everybody the same. He loves everyone, but the way that people experience his love and the blessings of his love is different depending on their receptiveness to his love and their own personal choices. He pours out his blessing upon people, and they experience his love depending on their receptiveness of it. You cannot love all people the same way. You can love them mentally the same way, but in your doing of good. For example, there's certain people, because of the way they're living and the choices they made, you wouldn't just invite into your house and say, let's sit down and eat greens and taters together. Because you may, you know, neck will be cut, you know, if they come into your house, or everything in your house stolen, or whatever, you know, because they have made some choices about their lifestyle. So when we talk about doing good, we're talking about seeking of the Lord's leadership to meet a need in their life, to show them God's care and compassion in a way that is meant to help connect them with God. To see that this is coming from God, because I don't deserve it, but it's coming from God. So you seek of the Lord's leadership to do something good. Don't just think, you do something good. And then second, talk good. You do good, you taught good. Jesus said, bless those who curse you. Bless those. A blessing is a positive word that is spoken about someone or to someone. If you speak a blessing upon someone, you're speaking a positive word about somebody or directly to them. Just because somebody speaks negatively about you or to you doesn't mean you have to return negative for negative. You think the world does that. Somebody says something bad about you, you return the favor, say something bad about him. Jesus says, you want to be like God. Even when somebody says something bad about you, you don't have to say something bad about them. You can have a blessing. Now, if you want to say, just make up something about somebody, oh, that person is so kind and so sweet when the whole world knows they're the devil. You know, it's kind of like, you know, when you do a funeral for someone that's been a heathen, you know, how do you say something good about them? Well, you know, those are hard ways many times when I'm a preacher, the priest, but most times I'm going to speak the truth. Well, God said, I'm not going to lavish on praise where a person hasn't been worthy of praise. But he, simply here, he's saying, talk good. Don't think you have to return a cursing for a curse, but return good, even for evil. And then the third thing, he says, pray good. Pray good. You do good, you talk good, and you pray good. He says, pray for those who mistreat you. Now, there have been some people, oh yeah, I want to pray for them, all right. I want to pray you know, hellfire and brimstone down upon them, you know, because of the way they treat me, and sometimes we feel like that. But in Romans 2, verse 4, it says, don't you know that the riches of God's kindness, his forbearance, and his patience are intended to lead people to repentance? God shows his goodness, and we do good, even to the people that are evil, for the purpose of connecting them to God. But sometimes people resist that. Sometimes people will not receive it. But we're to pray good. We're to pray that the light of Jesus Christ would break through in this person's life through the kindness shown by me and others and the kindness of God, the patience with God, and that through the working of God and the goodness that they would be drawn to repentance. Yet some people still resist God's kindness. They still resist their naked step against God. How do you pray for them? You ever notice sometime in the scripture that these passages where, like, for example, King David says, Lord, strike them dead. Shut the mouths of the liars. You ever feel like that? Yes, sir. And there's so much untruth being said today. Shut the mouths of the lying, of the deception. Stop the evil in the world. And we see this balance in the scripture of praying good, praying for salvation, but realizing there's some that are set in evil. They're set on doing harm. And if you're loving, you don't encourage harm. You don't become content with the harm and the evil that's in the world. But you pray in regards to it. You pray that it stops. You pray that evildoers stop. If they won't turn to the Lord, they'll be stopped. A couple things about that. When you see David and how he addressed evil in his world and evil that was attacked against the people of God, never did he seek personal vengeance. He said, Lord, stop him. Remember like when King Saul was king, and there came a point in Saul's life when he decided that I'm king. I'm going to have my own thing. I'm going to do my own thing. I don't need God. I can tell people what to do, and I can do my own way. I don't need God. And he's in his own way, and God said, okay, you're not going to come back to me. You're going to go? Fuck off. And King Saul had such a bitter, angry, jealous spirit because he saw that the hand of God was on David. Young David was growing up, and God had placed his hand on David and said, you have a heart after God. I'm going to anoint you. I'm going to make you king. And Saul knew it. And he was so jealous of David, he sought repeatedly to kill David against the instructions of God and the plan and the purpose of God to make David king. And there were several David knew, and he was running from King Saul. There were several opportunities when David could kill King Saul. He could have taken vengeance on Saul. He said, I'm not going to do it. I will not touch the Lord's anointed. Right now, King Saul is still king. God wants to remove him, he can remove him. He can take vengeance, but I'm not. But there are also times we see David, he didn't seek the personal vengeance, but he would pray to God and say, God, shut the mouths of the liars. Stop the evil. Stop the evildoers from their evil. Why? Because evil is bringing harm on the world. It is never loving not to pray that evil be stopped. If we accept evil, if we accept sin, just don't do anything about it, just let it go, and we're not being loving, because sin always degrades, it cheapens, it steals, and it kills. But when you love, you pray good. You pray that people will receive the light of Jesus Christ, that they saved, they turn to Him. You've been doing good, you've been speaking good, you're praying that they turn, but if they don't, you pray that the evil would stop, and God would bring an end to it. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. What is this kingdom? It's a good kingdom. Not a kingdom where evil reigns. So, you do good, you talk good, and you pray good. One other thing, on the back of your outline, if you're going to become more loving, you must draw on God's enablement. You must draw on God's enablement. Hopefully you've gotten the idea right now, I can't live this way on myself. I can't love with God's love on my own. That's right, you can't. That's why you have to experience God's love, as we call it, back point number two, and you have to draw on the enablement of God. Philippians 4, verse 13 says this, I can do all this through Him, through God, who gives me the strength. I can do all this. Does the all of this include loving people that are not very loving? Certainly. All this. I can do all this. I can love even the unloving through Him who strengthens me. So acknowledge, God, I cannot do this on my own. I must have you working through my life, pouring out your love in me so that it flows through me. And then one of the passages we've referred to it several times when we've been talking about patience, when we've been talking about burnout, when we've been talking about worry, we're talking about drawing on the enablement of the Holy Spirit within us. Galatians 5, verse 22. But the fruit of the Spirit is, what's the first thing He says? Love. The fruit of the Spirit. You want to know what the Holy Spirit does when He has control of a person's life? He produces love. Not the world's kind of love. Not even just a feeling. But He produces this love of God that is keeping the good of God in the lives of people. What is best for people? That's the enablement of God. That God enables you to do cannot do in yourself, but it's the power of God working through you. Guess what? It is that kind of love that transforms lives and will change our world. Do you know that kind of love? If you're here today and you've never received Jesus Christ, I encourage you to place your faith in the death, burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ as being completely sufficient to your salvation. That it's because of the death of Jesus Christ that your sins are forgiven, and that you're brought into a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. But some of you, you're believers, but you've got some really difficult people to love. And you say, God, I need to be saturated in your love so that love will flow through me to the people I work with, go to school with, play ball with, interact with. I need your love. So would you bow your heads with me as we ask God's working in our lives? Father God, we thank you that you're so loving toward us. Even while we were sinners, you died for us. Even while we were stiff-necked and resisting you, you loved us and poured out that love over and over again. But your love is not just for us to receive, it's for us to show and to give to our world that needs your love so much. May we be people infused, empowered with your great, great love. I pray for some here today that don't sense love. They don't, maybe don't sense they're loved by you or anybody else. I pray that they would know your great love and the love of the body of Christ in a way that fills them and thrills them with who you are. In the wonderful name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Let's stand together as we sing.
They call Him Jesus, He sent to us, He'll answer you.
Sing that without smiling and rejoicing at the greatness of our Savior, His love for you, and then how the hope you have in Jesus Christ for today, tomorrow, and the future is alive because of the living Savior. One way you can do love is by the Operation Christmas Child. It's not the only way, but it's one way that we use the opportunity to be a part of. We just have a short video that reminds you of the importance of that. Would you be seated? Just a moment.
Of the cross doesn't change, we will make every effort to share the gospel.
The world has been decimated by COVID-19, but the work here at Samaritan's Purse, it never stops. No greater need and no greater time than right now for us to go out and serve boldly in the name of Jesus Christ, and we do it through Operation Christmas Child. It's a platform that God has given Samaritan's Purse to share the gospel more than 10 million times every year.
The wonderment of it is that the child's encounter is not with material things. Our great encounter is with whom I see, and they're receiving that for the very first time.
Stand with us, please, as we close this morning and sing it with us.
Faith is a victory, faith is a victory, oh, glorious victory that overcomes the world. And faith is a victory, faith is a victory, oh, glorious victory that overcomes the world.